When I was 9 years old, a small airship flew over my school in Kent during our lunch break. It was a lightship A60 plus, a little bit like that one, advertising Mazda cars, and I'd never seen anything like it in my life. I stood there for as long as I could, watching it bump around in the cloudy skies above my school until it disappeared into the distance. Little did I know then, but that moment, that lunch break, was one of the most significant moments of my life because it sparked a passion for airships that has never left me. Sadly, airships are a very rare sight in our skies these days. Few people have seen one, let alone flown in one. And let's test that theory. Hands up those of you, and I'm going to have to look through the lights here. Hands up those of you who have flown in an aeroplane. Yeah, that's the vast majority of you. Hands up then those of you who have, slightly different question, been on a cruise ship. A decent percentage. Hands up then those of you who have flown in an airship, not a hot air balloon, but an airship. I know about you over there. But otherwise, tumbleweed. Well, a few years after I saw that airship, I was fortunate enough to fly on, and actually to fly, the Goodyear blimp. And this remains one of the outstanding memories of my life, organized, in fact, by my dad, who's here today. Thank you very much indeed, Dad. For years afterwards, actually, that did deserve a round of applause. He didn't know what he was doing when he did that. For years afterwards, whenever anyone would ask me what I wanted to be when I left school, I'd say, well, I want to be an airship pilot, of course. Strange child, I'm sure many people thought. And needless to say, that ambition did not quite come to fruition. And obsessively reading about the history of airships, I came to realize that my dream to fly was far out of reach because of a single moment nearly 90 years ago. A moment that cut short the airship dream and robbed the world of a unique and valuable technology. And I think that that loss is something that we should think about, because it's not just that we've lost a uniquely photogenic form of transport, and objectively, airships do look pretty cool. My concern is that because of this one moment nearly 90 years ago, we've lost a form of aircraft that could make a positive contribution to the modern world. An aircraft that can lift heavy loads and move them thousands of miles. An aircraft that can hover in the same place for days on end. An aircraft that can deliver life-saving humanitarian aid directly to the point of need without infrastructure. An aircraft that can transport passengers in spacious comfort as opposed to the cramped conditions on airliners. An aircraft that can do all of this in a genuinely sustainable way, using low or zero emission or even electric propulsion. All of this lost to us because of a single moment nearly 90 years ago. 7:25 p.m. on the 6th of May, 1937. Lakehurst Naval Air Station, New Jersey. The German airship LZ-129 Hindenburg, the largest flying object ever seen, hovers around 800 feet from her mooring mast. Late arriving into Lakehurst because of earlier thunderstorms, she is moments away from successfully completing her first transatlantic voyage of the 1937 season. On board, her 36 passengers, that's about half her capacity of 70, scan the waiting crowd for glimpses of friends and family. Forward, in the airship's control car, the Zeppelin's captain, Max Preuss, calls down a cheery hello to Charles Rosendahl of the US Navy, the air station commander, and himself a brave and experienced airshipman. There, Rosendahl later wrote, in an imposing silence, the vast silvery hulk of the Hindenburg hung motionless like a framed, populated cloud. Many people seem to have experienced that same motionless moment, that same sudden silent pause that Rosendahl described. Passengers in the ship's comfortable lounge reported feeling as if everything had grown strangely silent. Then observers on the ground noticed a lick of flame shoot up from the stern of the airship on the port side, and they saw the ship's fabric covering flutter strangely. Officers in the control car initially thought that perhaps one of the long mooring lines had snapped, and senior officer Albert Samt looked out of the window, and to his horror, he saw the vast airship hangar lit up in a fiery reflection. And at the same time, someone in the control car called out the sickening news that the Hindenburg was on fire. If you know one thing about airships, you know the Hindenburg disaster. Even today, it's hard to find a news report or an article about airships that doesn't feature those grimly iconic photographs or the raw emotion of Herb Morrison's Over the Humanity commentary. After nearly 90 years, the tragedy still endures. But there are very good reasons why it endures. Quite obviously, those photographs and film reels are among the most iconic of the 20th century. The story they capture is unique. More than that, what they capture is a genuine watershed moment where the relentless train of history switches from one track to the other in front of our very eyes. Because there were two tragedies on the 6th of May, 1937. The first was the immediate, personal, human tragedy of the wreck of the Hindenburg. The second was the death of a dream and the loss of an entire technology. Because back then, at 7:25 p.m. on the 6th of May, 1937, it really did seem as if airships had established themselves as the future of long-distance air travel. The Hindenburg was the apogee, the sum of everything that had been learned about airship design through decades of trial and error, blood, sweat, and tears, and hard-won empirical knowledge. She was supposed to make airship travel not a grand adventure, as in the early days, but a routine and dependable form of transport, attractive to celebrities, to politicians, and captains of industry. She could fly from Germany to the United States in a little over 2 days, making a little under 2 days on the return trip. And the only alternatives were either a pleasant but long voyage on an ocean liner or a series of noisy, cramped, uncomfortable, and dangerous hops via flying boat. Back then, in those days, many people foresaw commercial aviation as a hub and spoke system where long-distance airships like the Hindenburg would fly passengers into hubs where they would then change to aeroplanes for the shorter final legs of their journey. So although we look back now and see the triumph of the aeroplane as inevitable, back then, at 7:25 p.m. on the 6th of May, 1937, that was far from apparent, quite the reverse. But it all changed in the fraction of a second, and the appalling PR fallout from the Hindenburg disaster has bedeviled the airship business ever since. Growing up, I immersed myself in the study of airships, their history, their design, their capabilities, and it became clear to me that the airships of the early 20th century were just prototypes, just examples of what could be achieved today. Modern airships using modern materials and modern technology could play useful roles in the modern economy. And comparing a high-tech modern airship with an airship even as advanced as the Hindenburg would be exactly like comparing a contemporary cruise ship to the Titanic. Similar in concept, but entirely different in terms of design, materials, and safety standards. It makes me genuinely sad that we've gone from this to this. The once kings of the skies reduced to the status of flying billboards, no matter how cool the artwork. Now, of course, these little airships play an important role, And frankly, they've kept the industry going over the years. But they are very basic aircraft, and they don't come close to showcasing what high-tech modern airships could do. Now, it goes without saying that all modern airships use safe helium as their lifting gas, not flammable hydrogen, as in the Hindenburg. Materials such as carbon fiber and titanium are both stronger and lighter than the metal used in the Zeppelins of old. And thanks to better engines and vectored thrust, the days of needing an army of ground crew are over. But critically, high-tech modern airships would be the most sustainable form of aviation. Airships need far less thrust than aeroplanes to remain airborne, and that makes them ideal platforms for the development of low emission, zero emission, and electric propulsion. But what could they do? What could high-tech modern airships, what roles could they perform in the 21st century? Well, there are plenty, and they all tend to hit a sweet spot for transport needs that are slower than an aeroplane, faster than a surface ship, but with greater carrying capacity than a helicopter. And here are some examples. The first, cargo transport. Now, I think that that is the best example of that sweet spot I just mentioned between conventional aviation and surface ships. Modern airship designs, advanced modern airship designs, are designed to be able to lift very beefy cargo loads and transport them over considerable distances. Many are designed to be able to go directly from the factory to the point of use, and others are designed, unlike most aeroplanes, to be able to carry unusually shaped items. Think wind turbine blades, nuclear reactors, that sort of thing. The second, humanitarian aid and disaster relief. One of the critical aspects of disaster relief is getting enough life-saving aid and resources directly to the point of need in the aftermath of an event such as an earthquake. Quite often, your critical infrastructure like roads and airports is damaged, and that life-saving aid can take days to get to where it needs to go. Advanced modern airship designs are designed to be able to land with no infrastructure at all. A reasonably flat surface will do. Others are designed to be able to hover and offload their cargo that way. The third example, surveillance. Unlike aeroplanes, which must be constantly in motion in order to stay airborne, airships derive their lift from the lighter-than-air gas inside their hull. What this means is they can stay in the same place for days on end. Unmanned airships can, and indeed do, provide persistent surveillance of assets such as rail infrastructure or energy infrastructure. And these unmanned airships have far greater carrying capacity, endurance, and range than a drone, and they operate at far lower costs than conventional aviation. The final example, passenger transport. And as much as I love a good bit of heavy lift cargo transport or unmanned surveillance, this is the one as far as I'm concerned. I can't imagine how wonderful it must have been to have flown in one of the great airships of the 1920s and 30s. Passengers on the Hindenburg traveled in spacious comfort. They ate the finest food that has ever been served in the air, and they drank the finest wines. They traveled at low altitude, and with very little noise, they could reportedly hear dogs barking on the ground. Imagine sipping a cocktail and watching the great sights of the world drift by slowly beneath you. For those of you who, like me, love flying and love travel, this is the good stuff, the return of excitement and glamour to aviation. It's not the transactional A to B flying that we're familiar with, but a grand aerial adventure like something out of Jules Verne. And imagine having that experience, knowing that you are using a genuinely sustainable low-emission form of transport. So those are just some of the roles that modern airships could perform. And for airship nerds like me, there are some very real reasons for hope in some of the projects currently under development. And just two examples. This is Pathfinder 1, being developed by LTA Research. She's the largest aircraft built in decades. And in what has long been a dream of would-be airship producers, she's the brainchild of a billionaire enthusiast. And who doesn't want a billionaire enthusiast fighting your corner? In this case, it's Google's Sergey Brin. Pathfinder 1 is the first in a line of planned larger airships. And I mentioned before that airships are ideal platforms for the development of electric propulsion. Well, Pathfinder 1 is powered entirely by 12 electric motors. On this side of the pond, hybrid air vehicles continues to develop their low-emission airlander aircraft. And I remember how excited I was back in 2016 when the prototype took to the skies over Bedfordshire. Some of you may recognize her as the flying bum, as the media christened her. But hybrid air vehicles continues to make progress. They recently released a study showing the very real impact that Airlander would have in linking far-flung Scottish islands to the mainland. They are also working on converting Airlander to entirely electric propulsion. Airships really will be zero emission long before conventional aviation. I'm convinced that large airships will return, that these once kings of the sky will rule again. All my life, I've looked to the skies in a vain search for airships. And now my own future is somewhat uncertain. Some of you may know me as a member of the London Assembly, but after 20 years, more than 20 years, in politics, I'm moving on to pastures new. I'm not 100% sure what that looks like yet, but I do know that it will involve my greatest passion. I'm not an engineer, but I can advocate, campaign, and persuade. And my hope is that I can help to inspire the next generation of airship engineers, airship pilots, and airship nerds. And that's one of the objectives behind my forthcoming podcast about the fascinating history of airships. They say that we are shaped by our childhood experiences. And for me, that is very much the case. I stand on this stage as the 9-year-old boy, fascinated by the strange aircraft pootling around in the skies above my school. And I hope that any of you out there with nerdy aviation-obsessed kids like I was will do those kids a favor and give them a book about airships. I guarantee they will be captivated by what they read. Because airships aren't just another form of transport. They are not just another means of moving goods and people from A to B. They are fabulous, ethereal pieces of engineering, capable of inspiring awe and wonder in ways that conventional aircraft simply cannot hope to do. Because airships simultaneously look back to a more romantic age, whilst looking forward to a future of genuinely sustainable, zero-emission aviation. Because just as we must live the good life on the ground, so too must we live the good life in the skies. Thank you.